On his way to be inaugurated in 1861, Abraham Lincoln stopped by Independence Hall in Philadelphia and said, "I have never had a feeling politically that did not spring from the sentiments embodied in the Declaration of Independence. I have often pondered over the dangers which were incurred by the men who framed and adopted the Declaration, pondered over the toils that were endured by the officers and men of the Army who achieved that independence. I have often inquired of myself, what great principle or idea was it that kept this Confederacy so long together?"
My name does not matter. These are not my hands. These were our hands. This is not my musket. It was our musket. At Concord, Bunker Hill, at Long Island, at Yorktown. Yorktown, Virginia, October 19. They're starved, they're beaten, they surrender, these British. So they put on new uniforms. My Lord, I'm tired. I ache to go home to Boston. It's all over now. 7 long years out of my life. 1781. I'll be 41 next month. Revere can be a silversmith again. But what am I going to do? There's Washington. God bless him. How much we piled on his back. And Knox, our general of artillery. I wonder if he'll reopen his bookstore in Boston. We're free. It doesn't seem possible that we've won, that we've held together so long. Our last king, poor George, out of his mind, wandering about his palace like a lost soul. But he was a grand figure once, so splendid in 65. 65. It was a year of anxiety for us. Yes, His Majesty was splendid. So was Windsor Castle. And His Majesty's favorite is Swan Ship at Kew Gardens. And so was the national debt of 130 million pounds sterling. They boast, these English, of their new empire, which Pitt has won for them in his 7 years' war. But who'll pay for it? Everywhere I go, Englishmen seem to think themselves a piece of sovereign over America. Our subjects in the colonies, that's all I hear. As I listen to this Grenville, the King's minister in Commons, the bleating shepherd, they call him, I see little hope for us. The King and his Tories mean to enforce their buy British only policy that's ruining us. If only Pitt, our friend, were back in power. He and Edmund Burke and Charles Fox strive valiantly for us, for the rights of man everywhere, but to no avail. I'm going home. My fellow Boston merchants have wasted their money sending me here to protest. Ben Franklin's brought me word of the new stamp tax bill. Good Lord. Intercepted by the British. It's unbelievable. They're forcing us to Halifax, not Boston. A trumped-up smuggling charge. Judged, fined, prize money for the Navy, no trial by jury. That's justice for you. Boston at last. Can't get the Admiralty Court out of my mind. You never realize what a trial by jury means until they take it away from you. Off for home. My friend and neighbor Paul Revere tells me there's a boycott on. No more buy British. Gloves, expensive gowns. I wonder what my wife will say to that. No more lamb. No more imported beer, she'll say, like those Philadelphians are doing. Paul's persuasive. Tomorrow I ride with him to Virginia for our committee of correspondence. They This young Virginia lawyer, Patrick Henry, shocks me with his defiant resolves. George is still my king. But that Virginians should only tax Virginians, this I believe. New York and our first Congress. We meet on Wall Street. Resolved that the colonies should only tax colonists. This too we believe. We spread our Declaration of American Rights everywhere. What is an American? I cannot say, but I know I'm no longer just a New Englander. Boston. The kettle is boiling over. Our town meetings swirl with factions. Our Tories would have us obey the stamp tax. That position's impossible to live with. Lawyer John Adams counsels prudence. We must try. But his cousin Sam, that brewer, will plunge us into violence yet with his radical call for freedom. God knows what that would lead to. Poor wretch. The mood of the cities is dangerous. Trade's at a standstill everywhere. Unemployment is spread. I may have to take my boy out of Harvard. To survive is to smuggle. I'm sorely tempted. God, I cannot. No one dares to bring out the stamp paper anywhere. I have a new son, but he's not mine yet legally. I will not buy a stamp for the birth certificate, for any certificate. I don't care how much it will cost me. London. Townshend, whom they call the Weathercock, is in power now. Our friends, that eloquent Irishman Burke and Fox, are still with us. Our fight is their fight. Repeal. No more stamps, thank God. But the king will not let well enough alone. Now they're taxing paper, glass, paint, and tea, and recruiting soldiers. Boston, at Faneuil Hall with Revere, the weathercock has thrown us a bone. Rum is cheaper now, and it sticks in our throats. Now they've forced themselves into our businesses and our homes with writs. Writs. Why, they're nothing more than blank search warrants. Let them put us all in jail. We're all smugglers now. We protest. They dissolve our legislatures across the land. We defy the customs officials. We defy the Royal Navy. We defy the King's ministers. Royal troops. John Churchill's famed West Yorkshires. The 29th Worcestershires. The King's men. We marched with them, fought with them, and bled with them against the French. And now they've come to Boston as policemen. Pray that John Adams has truly persuaded our hotheads to passive disobedience. No one will offer them lodgings in town. They pitch tents on our commons. They commandeer public and private billets under pretext of law. Roils the blood. Now, for the first time, I want a musket in my hands. Officers at my door. A Major Pitcairn of the Royal Marines. We debate. We plan, we arm, and we wait. Pitcairn has won my trusted affection, but he is still an intruder in my home. I will never accept that. Neither will my neighbors. They're paid nothing, so they hire themselves out for a pittance. Our children mock them. Hey, bloody back. Hey, lobsters for sale. Our unemployed gang up on them in the streets. They retaliate. Sentries challenge you over and over. They harass us everywhere. Don't fire. ruffians, but we mourn our dead. Sam Adams is rousing the colonies to a fever pitch with Revere's etching of the massacre. He will not let it die. Unhappy Boston, see thy sons, deplore thy hallowed walks, be smeared with guiltless gore. Narragansett Bay, June 1772. HMS Gaspé will raid us no more. They punish us. 342 chests of tea to fatten the pockets of the East India Company and Governor Hutchinson's nephew. Into Boston Harbor, dumped. Into New York's East River, dumped. Charleston, confiscated. The coercive acts, more troops. Boston is now an occupied city. We cannot meet openly. Our sheriffs, our judges, our very juries are taken from us. Philadelphia, another Congress. The carpenters have lent us their hall. Thank God for our friends. Our plight has aroused them to the common danger. Charleston sends money and rice. Brooklyn, 100 sheep. Connecticut, 100 sheep and General Israel Putnam. Resolved, we will gather arms, we will form our own militia. We will collect taxes on our own. We pray for divine guidance. The king's ministers must come to their senses. Surely Englishmen cannot have forgotten what it means to be free. No reconciliation. Chastisement. They're pushing General Gage. Arrest Sam Adams. Disrupt our provisional government at Lexington. Seize our powder and stores at Concord. April 18, 2 a.m. Gage orders out the elite of his army, his flank companies. The bloodybacks bayonet their pet dogs. No alarm must be given, but we know their every move. Revere warns Sam Adams before they take him. We form on Lexington Green, companies, minute, and alarm. An unexpected volley. Major Pitcairn just 10 yards away from me. Robert Monroe is falling at my side, Jonas Parker. I'll never believe Pitcairn ordered his men to fire. But it doesn't matter now. They've drawn our blood. They're past the cemetery to Concord. It's a grand music. North Bridge. We wait. They fire. There's no question now who shot first. It's on their heads. They're breaking. They're veterans. The best they have are breaking. We pursue them. Farmers, merchants, workers. We hound them. We harry them. They stagger into Boston. June 16. We're ordered out to fortify Bunker and Breed's Hill overlooking the harbor. Colonel Prescott and old Putnam are at us through the night to finish the redoubt, the earthworks, and the rail fence. I can hear the little English drummer boys flailing away. I mustn't panic. Three times they come at us up those bloody slopes under that hot June sun. Three times they struggle through the blackberry bushes and over the fences. Our muskets are empty. We retreat. night brings shattering weariness to us all. I grieve for the fallen. Our Dr. Warren, that wonderfully sunny man. Major Pitcairn, who will grace my home no longer. And so many, many more. Philadelphia, the Congress once more. Rebellion, the awful realization of it assails us. No time for regrets. The hills of Boston swarm with disorganized militia. Who is to command us all? Excitement today. The chair recognizes John Adams. His nominee, Washington of the Virginia delegation. Hancock is stunned. He expected the job. Colonel Washington refuses the $500 a month we offer him. He will accept expenses only. Granted. I have my misgivings about this rich planter. He's only 43. He has little experience. With the general at Cambridge, there's no sleep for us. All is chaos. Officers quarrel over seniority. Nothing on paper, no lists of units, men, supplies, flimsy shelters, no sanitation, no medical service. Cannon, none. Powder, almost none. Ammunition, lacking. Old Putnam is offering a tot of rum for each round of British shot recovered. But it's better than we dared hope. Our people are coming from everywhere to answer the call. The poor and the rich, the young and the old, from the north and the south, from the east and the west, from the mountains, from the farms and plantations, from the villages and cities, Baltimore, Savannah, Salem, from Portsmouth, Charleston, Hartford, and Charlotte, from the colleges, Harvard, Yale, Princeton, King's College, Brown, William and Mary, and still more come. Trappers, runaway slaves to buy their freedom with army pay. From the cricket fields, from the mills, knife grinders and shoemakers, from the printers, teamsters, blacksmiths, paper makers, from the synagogues and churches, Catholics, Protestants, even some Quakers, from the foot-washing Amish, Moravians, French Huguenots, Dutch, Germans, Irish, Swedes, free Negroes, physicians, lawyers, fishermen, chimney sweeps, tinkers. Winter. The siege drags on. Enemy-occupied Boston starves. But the army is taking shape. Our insubordinate, undisciplined New Englanders are beginning to obey orders. Only the general could have done it. He's an inspiration to us all. Enlistments are running out. We plead, the general pleads, that the militiamen leave. They have their families, their livelihoods to think about. Not everybody cares enough. The boycott against the enemy falters. Loyalists are everywhere in discouraging numbers. We've had to put Ben Franklin's Tory son, William, in jail. Thank God for Knox. Precious cannon all the way from Fort Ticonderoga. Other volunteers are coming forth, but we still must start all over again. We're true rebels now. All of us here and in Congress walk daily in the shadow of the hangman. Philadelphia, the Congress. Still endless debates, endless objections, endless problems. But above all, John Adams and the Lees of Virginia hammer home independence and union day after day after day. They stand like a rock, impervious to assault. There's no withstanding them. I have no king any longer. Common sense. The words of that Englishman Tom Paine reverberate through the land now. O ye that love mankind, ye that dare oppose not only the tyranny but the tyrant, stand forth, receive the fugitive, and prepare an asylum for mankind. Is this then the meaning of our rebellion? At his lodgings at the home of Graff, the bricklayer, young Tom Jefferson, reached into his mind, his heart, and his soul. Into our minds, our hearts, and our souls. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of those ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it and to institute new government. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance upon divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. Manhattan, New York, July 9. I've rejoined the general. As I stand here in the ebb of the day listening to our declaration, none of us New Englanders, New Yorkers, nor Southerners any longer, but Americans, I most somberly ponder the road ahead. The defeat of Tom Jefferson's attempt in the declaration to denounce slavery troubles me. The full might of that powerful empire, Britain, have yet to feel its fist. We can expect the utter destruction of our cities, invasion of all our homes. Savages turned loose on our frontiers. But we have more than our lives or our property to fight for now. Man is not made for the state, but the state for man. This is my faith. Here is the eternal answer to all forms of tyranny over the persons, the property, and the minds of men. Later that night, we hauled down our last king on Bowling Green. We needed the lead for bullets.